A lot of hello technical issues. Had a lot of technical issues. So this is rolling now. The taping keeps getting crashing. Had a dream last night where we had to flee some very bad situation, and we came on this road, and suddenly this huge mudslide had covered the entire road. It was just impossible to get through, impossible. And I said, "Uh-oh. This isn't good." And suddenly this huge truck came and it just poured this crushed rock all the way across the mud area and made this perfect road that we could drive across. And I drove right across it and got across to the other side of the road, and everything was great. No problem at all. It just happened so quickly, so quickly. So I hardly had time to really to get upset. I was just kind of saying, "Huh, how am I going to get past this?" And then boom, the truck was there. And smoothed it all out and was able to get across. Wow. So we're just if we can get this taping and actually push it through, it'd be great. I'm having troubles now. I'm having troubles knowing what to say and how to go about this at this point. It's really I'm having I've had well I don't even know what to say. But we can just hang out here. Okay, that's the best thing to do, is just hang out. That's the kind of part of the service that I can offer right now, is just a place to hang out and to listen to something really interesting. I watched the opening heats of the 2017 World Surf League Championship Tour in Snappers in Australia. That was interesting, watching it streaming live on the internet. And but I said, "Ah, that's enough of that," because the judging is so, it's pretty subjective, and you end up disagreeing with the judges, results. You say, "No. Why'd they give Mick Fanning a, 7-3 on that last wave? Well, it's a local favorite, I don't know why." So I irritated by it. I said, "Oh, forget it, forget it. It's not worth it." But John Florence was surf just wow, fabulous, world champ, just great. He looked so good and flawless. I said, "Wow, this guy is really top notch, no doubt about it." So it'll be interesting to see how John surf this year. But we have other fish to fry, that is for sure. However, there's only so much I can say at this point, because I've had so many breakthroughs now that it's all been settled basically for me. I've seen what I need to see, and I can now explain it just like that. And I can explain it all. I can explain everything away, just boom, like that. It's that easy for me now. Now, this is a problem, because in no way is it that easy for hardly anyone else. And the problem is people are used to struggling with complexity and all this stuff. And if somebody just comes and directly, clearly fit, just settles it all like that, they're going to feel like they're being attacked. Really, it's going to feel like an attack to them, even though the words aren't an attack and the intent is not an attack. They feel their familiarity is being too strongly attacked. See, it's familiarity that we're protecting. So, I can't really lay it out the way I see it now. I cannot, which is okay, because I see it beautifully right now. I've just pushed through. I started out with Apex Yoga February 13th, and it's been about a month now, a little over a month, and that's it. It made this push, and I've had trouble sleeping. I wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning. The stress is very strong, but I'm able to push through it somehow. It's like, oh gosh, what do I do then? What do I do now? I can't. What can I say? Had very interesting days, very stressful days. Trying to just going through this, change of expectation. I don't know what I'm going to do. Maybe I'll be more helpful by singing than, saying anything. It's possible. It's possible. It's kind of like the analogy is like, let's say there's some surfers out and there's some surfers inside, kind of close to the beach, and there's some big waves breaking, and they're inside, and they get caught inside. And they get hammered by the white water, just hammered. Where there's some others that are outside. They've paddled out quickly, and they make it over the waves, and nothing. They're not touched by them. Why do they? Some get caught inside because maybe they're squabbling, you know, over trivial stuff, and they're not paddling out like they should be really fast. So I'm like, my situation is like I paddled out really, really fast. I just put my head down and said, I have to go as fast as possible and just paddle out, and just trust that there's really tough times coming. So that's 60 years of that. I just trusted that there's going to be very, very difficult times coming. And that was, I was born with that feeling in 1956. So I have been working full speed, Ferrari speed, my whole life, actually. So I'm not surprised that I've made it outside, really, to the safety zone. I'm not surprised at all. That's where I expected to be. That was my goal in life. So, but the others have not made it out, it's obvious. So they're going to get hammered. So I know that. So the question then is, like, what do you do? What do you do? Because, like, when you get hammered by whitewater, you're kind of disoriented for a while. I mean, you're just like, you're alive, but you're just like, you know, your expectation, like, whoa, what happened? It's very, very tough experience. I mean, I was a surfer for quite some time and experienced pretty much everything the ocean has to throw at you. And so I know what it's like to really, really get hammered. And yeah, you just feel like you can't go on at some point. If you get hammered enough times, you just feel, I just got to go back into the beach and I just got to lie down. I can't go on. This is like what's happening with the world. We're just getting hammered right now. I'm getting hammered from every angle. It's just unbelievable what's happening, actually. I can't even tell you what's happening. Just bizarre. Just bizarre. And so, but I'm fine. I'm fine. Be able to find that inner calm, and I know I have it. I know I have it. I can't lose it now. I cannot lose what I've seen. It's very clear. So I'm just wowing it. But the rest of you are going to get hammered. And so what do you do when that happens? You know, how do you help out? It's kind of hard to say, well, it's just this, da, 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 like that, get it. It doesn't work that way because of the familiarity problem and our expectations. It's not a learning situation. It's a familiarity situation. Okay, you can't learn enlightenment, or you can't learn liberation. You can't learn this. You have to get familiar with it. And how do you get familiar with it when you're all disoriented and just freaking out in every direction? You can't. So it's a problem, that's for sure. So how do you minimize the collateral damage is the question. So that's what's coming to my attention. It may be a situation of minimizing the collateral damage so that your momentum, you know, is not hurt as bad as it could be with this, what's coming up in the world. And so the question is, how do we do that? How is that possible? I don't know. I do know I'm singing a lot. The Holy Spirit has brought my attention to quite a bit of stuff in regard to singing. I've been singing for 40 years, actually. Now, I don't sound very good at this point, which is okay. It doesn't bother me. It doesn't bother me. Because I have a lot of X factors. And the voice, you know, it sometimes it sounds good, sometimes not so good. And it depends on how you feel. And I know it can just snap into place. I've had it happen to me where, boom, there it is. Because I feel relaxed and confident and clear-minded, and boom, the voice is there. Where if I'm super stressed out and exhausted and not sleeping and have all this crises on my head, of course my voice is not going to sound so good. So I don't worry about it because I have the musicality. I have the musicality. So I can be on stage with anyone in terms of just musicality. It's not a problem. And if the voice is there, then wow, you know, I can hold my own. And if it's not there, I can fake it. And step a little back to the side in the background and still stay with the musicality of it all. And so I don't, you know, what is the Holy Spirit up to? I don't know. It something seems to be in the works. And so I've been spending my days as I drive singing. I'm really singing a lot. I'm getting back into it. I've discovered some, you know, singing secrets, to say the least. And so I really feel like, you know, wow, I can do this. I can do this if called upon. maybe as a pick-me-up for people. You know, sometimes great music can just help people out a lot when they're really stressed out and they just don't know where to turn and they're lost. They're just lost. I mean, the world is right now, it's already lost. It's in a very much lost state, caught in the jaws of hope and fear. Caught in the jaws of hope and fear. And everybody, basically. I'm one of the few that's gotten free of it. I don't see many others getting free of it at this point. There may be some others that pull through. I hope so. So, when you're really lost, great music, just some music that you feel, wow, that just makes me feel that somewhere there's a God, you know, that something's okay somewhere. That can help. That can really, really help. Whereas like a lecture, you know, trying to explain something, it's not going to work. So I feel I've completed my sadhana. I've completed my spiritual practice. And I say, okay, what do I do? I've reached clarity about the central issues, really. And it's so amazingly simple. The whole thing. The whole game here. So I don't have any more sadhana, really, to do. Except allow this to settle in, and there'll be other breakthroughs that just come naturally. But you know that's fine. But I know that won't last long, and it's not really. I don't need to focus on it so much anymore. So I'm thinking, okay, what do I do? What do I do? I'm supportive teachers. I'm just encouraging all teachers in the world. Just, you know, pat on the back. Hey, thanks. Like a Facebook. Hey, thank you. You know, thank you so much for what you're doing. That's all I say. You know, I appreciate it. But I'm not going to say anything like give them some insights or anything. No, because they're going to feel like they're being attacked, actually. I don't want to do that. Just let them do the best they can, because they can be very helpful to help stabilize people, and it could, you know, it will work in some positive way, super positive way, most definitely. They can attract people who feel, you know, there's some hope here, and then maybe they can be given some hope also, and, you know, just kind of minimize collateral damage is what we're really engaged in right here. As far as really finishing your sadhana, your spiritual practice right now, yeah, maybe that won't happen for very many in this world. Very likely. But again, minimize that collateral damage. Really minimize it. And just feel good about yourself in some way, like something, somewhere the sun is shining. I feel this. So that takes the edge off of the panic. You don't want to go into panic. You might go into shock, but not into panic. We want to minimize the panic in the world. So I'm singing, the Holy Spirit guided me somehow. I don't even know how did it happen. I don't even remember. I kind of do. Guided me, at first it said, you should start singing some doo-wop for harmony, to learn harmony. I said, yeah, that's a great idea, because I was doing so great in harmony with the Beach Boys and George Jones, which are the two artists I've been singing with for a long time. And tried doo-wop. I said, okay. So I said, what's the best doo-wop? And I started searching on Amazon for a doo-wop CD. And finally, I narrowed it down to Dion DiMucci's Greatest Hits. I said, you know, it's so highly recommended. The reviews were so high. And for some reason, I decided on that one CD. I said, I'm going to get just this. I think this will give a really good cross-section of doo-wop. I don't know why I thought that. I felt that way, but I did. So I followed my gut, you know, the gut instinct, the Holy Spirit's guidance, and got that CD, Dion Belmont's Greatest Hits, or something like that, Dion's Greatest Hits. I started listening to it, and I've been listening to it more and more and more and more and more. I have it on sometimes, just going over and over and over and over and over, like I said, I'm at the computer. And this is how you really have to do it. If you're really going to tune into something, you have to really familiarize yourself with it. Truly. And I'm able to do that. I've been consistently done this throughout my life. So I will listen to something 100 times and 100 times more. And just gradually you really feel in sync with it. Really start feeling in sync with it. So then finally I started singing. I started singing with trying to do the harmony parts and stuff. And then ultimately I'm trying to sing along with Dion. And that's been quite a challenge, actually. I love it, but it's an exceptional challenge, I find. You know, he's blowing me off the stage, and I'm like, wow, this okay? I'm up for it. Let's. I'm shocked. I'm shocked. He's way better than I could imagine. I mean, he's just tremendously gifted, and what a challenge to try to sing even close to that. You know, he's just extraordinary, actually. I didn't know that. So I've been doing that a lot, and Holy Spirit showed me a secret of singing that has made a huge difference, actually, and it gave me a massive amount of confidence. But I'm not going to really talk about it, because singing has to come from the heart. It's about heart and soul and your spirit and musicality and focus and desire and purpose and context. That's what it's really about. And all these music teachers trying to teach, singing techniques, that's not what it's about at all. It's very misleading to tell somebody, well, just do this and you'll sing great. That is nonsense. That's nonsense. It gives them a false confidence. Just like Kelly Slater, I was listening to an interview with him, the greatest surfer of all time, and they asked him, Kelly, if there's one thing that you could advise the young up-and-coming surfers to, follow in your footsteps and have the success that you have, what would you tell them? And Kelly, being a very wise person, said, "Well, everyone's very unique, so I can't have any bit of advice to them as far as that. But they're very unique. But what I would say is that everyone follow your gut instincts. Do what you love," he said first. "Do what you love. Do what you're passionate about, and then follow your gut instincts." He says, "That's how I've been so successful. Is I follow this inner feeling I have. It's intuition. It's spiritual intuition," is what he's talking about. And he says, "When I do what that tells me to do, stuff works out great. When I don't, it doesn't work out good. And if I think, oh, this isn't going to work, it doesn't." So that's very sage advice, actually. Very, very sage advice. I was really impressed by that, because that's what I've done in my life, and that's what probably all of you have been doing, is following this inner destiny within that the grace of God has for you. So if it's your destiny to do something, something, then you will follow that with great intensity and purpose and all, and be wrapped up in it. And that's how you do it. Like Kelly said, that's how he's done what he's done. It's so along the way you might have all these techniques that you're aware of, but you cannot isolate those techniques from the overall context. You cannot. If you do, you're being a fool. Okay, don't be that fool. So don't ask people, well, how can you do this so good? And no, that's the wrong question altogether. It's follow the grace of God. It's the grace of God that's doing it all the way. And I'm just along for the ride. That's all. 2 days of very intense singing, and my voice is like kind of fried. But it's fun. It's I sort of understand now, like, how it's possible to really be able to just hang in there, and pretty much just sing anything, be able to hang with anyone. It's very possible. But I'll tell you this, great background singers are super important. Super important. If I had like some really great background singers, I'd feel very comfortable. It's like, hey, I got this. Because you just let them shine. Sometimes the background singers are the best singers there are, actually. But they just enjoy the creativity of it, you can, and just kind of blending their voices together. It's a skill, and it's a really big talent they have. So Dion had the Belmonts and the Del Satins too, the very best, and boy, do they sound just fabulous. And of course, Dion, being who he is, it's just his singing is just out of this world. Really, one of the best singers ever walked this planet, actually, in my experienced opinion, along with George Jones and some others. But he's up there with one of the very best. So you put that all together, it's a very potent mix, very potent mix. So background singers, yeah. If the world, I wish I. May the world be blessed with some great background singers right now. You know, really. Because you could hook great background singers up with various singers around the world. If I was hooked up with that, I'd say, hey, yeah, let's go. Let's do it. But without that, no. No, 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 no. Not at my age, and not at any age, actually. If you're going to do music to pick people up, you have to really have a great sound. And you get that through great vocals. And look at the great vocal. I mean, look at the Beach Boys. Look at the Bee Gees, for instance. Look at the Beatles. Look at these groups that have had great vocals, okay? Look at the doo-wop of Dion. Fabulous stuff. So it's this overall vocalization that is just superb, that really gets our attention. Because like we feel like we're part of it, right? We feel like we're part of it. So as far as just like being this, you know, vocal star, and you, it doesn't really do much for me. Like if you're just a solo act and you're just a great singer and you're singing really, that doesn't do much for me at all. Give me the Bee Gees or something, you know, that's just fabulous, right? Their harmonies. There's a lot going on there, and you feel you can join in. You can join in and sing, and you'll sound great when you're singing along with them, actually. That, you know, it's there's something about that. Whenever I'm singing with the Beach Boys, I always think I sound great, but I probably don't, because they make you sound good. So really, may the world be blessed with like the best backup vocal groups in history right now. And that could help the world out. It really could. People have been telling me how much music helps them. And at some point, you know, when you're so distraught, you're beyond words as far as someone trying to talk to you, it doesn't work anymore. I'm running into people who are having meltdowns right now. Meltdowns. And I can't say a word to them. Can't say a word to them. You'd be amazed at how many people are having meltdowns. And I'm getting stories right and left of people just absolutely, they can't keep it together anymore. Right and left. And I understand, because we are just being hammered right now. These are these times. So just roll with the times. I say, okay, that's great. I'll be fine. I'll be better than fine. And practice the wow. Like, wow. For me, I say, you know, wow. I've done it. Wow, I've done it. Wow, I've really done it. Wow, I can practice that way now. And, you know, rehearse your expectations. You must rehearse a new set of expectations related to ultimate success. That's really the key secret practice to the path. Rehearse your expectations in relation to ultimate success. Peace of God is the ultimate success, actually. Even beyond bliss, the peace of God. But don't be surprised if you don't reach that right at this point. Because it's the backlash can be very easily happen. Okay. I've been struggling with this for a long time. It's a work of great patience. You think plumbers have to have a lot of patience. They do. But the spiritual path requires the ultimate patience. Ultimate. Just cannot lose your temper or your nerve at all. You just have to find ways to stay confident and poised. Even when there seems to be, you know, no reason to, you still do it. An act of will. That's what it takes. That's what the spiritual path takes. It's a steady determination and to absolutely, you do not melt down. You do not have a meltdown. Even when you have a meltdown, you don't have a meltdown. It's like that. Even if you have a meltdown, you're still confident. Even that doesn't faze you. You just stay patient, you stay patient, you stay patient. Minimize the collateral damage and bounce back stronger than ever. That's exactly what it takes. So, Yeah, I've added Dion to my pantheon. He's on the Mount Rushmore of singers, really, in music. He really is. Yeah, hidden jewel. Most people don't realize that. But the more I listen to him, I listen very carefully. I can really hear what he's doing and feeling it. And then trying to sing it, you can tell it's so difficult. I mean, Elvis was easy. I just nailed Elvis from the start. You say, my gosh, Elvis is so easy. That's why there's so many Elvis impersonators. But there are sub-singers. You just can't touch them. They're so unique. Their style and vocals and everything. There's so much going on there. You don't realize it until you try to sing like them, and then it leaves you in the dust. Dion's got to be one of the most difficult song he does. Run Around Sue, that will just fry you. First time I tried it, I was about dead at the end of the song. I couldn't do it. I had to try. I tried it today. I'm much better at it, using some of the techniques I have now. So maybe I'll get there at some point. I believe I will. But what a challenge that song is, man! Because he just belts it up so high, and keeps going up there, and then from the lower registers, he goes back up high again and again and again, which is a problem with your breath control. How to sing great at the lower registers, the mid registers, and still have all that, reservoir and bounce off the higher registers. And the way he does it, that's superb singing technique he has. He's just a natural born genius singer. I dug into his life a bit and found out that he started singing at 5 years old. He's a natural born singing genius, and he actually had lots of singing from a very young age. It was on television shows, going on vaudeville circuit, traveling. I mean, he was like almost like a child star. I didn't know that. People don't know that. So he was just on the fast track since 5 years old. And so by the time he was a 22-year-old recording Run Around Sue in 1961, I mean, he's the most confident 22-year-old singer I've ever seen in my life. He's on YouTube. You see Run Around Sue. You see him sing that, and the stage presence he has, and the way he sings, I just, oh, he's lip singing, of course, but the movements he's making as he's singing it, holy cow. This is ridiculously confident. I've never seen anything like it. And so he knew he was a great singer. He knew that. So I got a fake, a false history of him kind of before. It wasn't quite accurate. He knew he was a great singer, and so he went into New York when he was signed to a label, and picked the two best street singers in New York where he lived. I think was it the Bronx maybe. He knew who the best singers were. And he just said, "Hey, come sing with me. Let's record some records." And they, boom, they started getting better and better and better. Those were the Belmonts. And then after a year and a half, they parted ways. Then he went it back into the streets of New York and got four guys, the Del Satins, who were, they're so good, it's ridiculous. And he just said, "Come on, and that's the pull he had. Just you're coming and singing with me. Let's make some hit records." And they just, looking back and what they did is some of the best music I've ever heard. At you're 22 years old, come on. Man. You don't see that kind of confidence very often. So he met the right people. His dad was involved, Bob Bill was a puppeteer. He was born into show business. He was a born showman, a born singer. And in New York, you can get very confident if you meet the right people. It's a place of confidence, New York. And when you are on the top of New York and you're having number one hits, man, are you just moving like the king of New York, king of the New York streets is what they call him. And he really was. He really, really was. You walk down the street, man, everybody said, "There goes the king of New York." There's Dion. And I can see why. Holy cow. Some of the best music ever recorded, actually. So I'm trying to keep up with a 22-year-old Dion at 60. And I can almost do it. Not quite, though. Not quite. So he's put the bar up very high. Very, very high. I said, "Wow, man, my throat. I mean, Dion, I might need to take a rest in the next couple of days. I don't know." Because I'm used to singing with George Jones and the Beach Boys, and so I think, yeah, I can handle myself pretty well. But he Dion goes up in the his young voice, this young, 20-year-old voice. He's got that. He go up the higher. Wow. And I have to really strain to hit that. I have to train myself, see if I can get up there or not. I don't know. But with power, he's belting it, and he's just flying all over the place. It's just wow. What a workout he gives. If you want a vocal workout, just sing, just get Dion and the Belmont's Greatest Hits. It's about like 19 songs, I think. Ends up with Martin, what is it? Abraham, Martin, and John, or something like that. That's a famous song, number one hitter. Beautiful song, soulful song. And he sings everything, the slow ballads, the slow dance stuff, the nostalgic stuff, the doo-wop, the rock and roll, the gospel. I mean, he sings everything, every style, great. A plus, every single style. And most people don't realize that. I said, wow, he can sing those slow, beautiful ballads just fantastically. And then the whole group, there's just what great music that is. So I'm really blessed to be able to spend the day just singing with this really, really great music. And I'm on a high, really flying high. Just people ask me, how you doing? I just say, I'm doing wonderful. Are you kidding me? I'm just belting with Dion like I'm part of the group. And the music was so, yeah, it was so beautiful back then, actually. It was beautiful music. It's so different now, isn't it? It just reflects that people are in this turmoil of hope and fear turmoil, and it's getting too intense because they feel they got to figure it all out somehow. They got to fixate, hallucination. They got to find a way to do it. And with technology coming in, it's changed everything because it's pushed everybody to think that if they just try harder, we'll finally succeed. Whereas before we said, you know what? I don't even know if we can succeed, and maybe wouldn't shouldn't be trying so hard to succeed. That's the great message of religion has brought to the world, spiritual teaching. Saved by the grace of God, not by any of your efforts in terms of trying to really fixate the mind. So, but now everybody thinks they can fixate the mind, that they have a way to do it. So this is what's causing all the trouble in the world, actually, and it's horrible trouble. Because the mind cannot be fixated. It's perfectly free and will always be perfectly free. There's nothing we can do about that. So the more we think there's a way to fixate it, the worse trouble we get into. The more intense the turmoil between hope and fear becomes. And the more polarized people become, and the more nasty they become. They think that they've got it. And they don't. They can't fixate the mind. But they feel that other people are attacking their position, and that's the reason why they still feel insecure. And it then turns very, very nasty in the world. And this has been going on for the last 100 years, actually, in this world, very badly, with the rise of the fruit of industrialization and modernization, all that kind of stuff, is overconfidence, believing that there must be a way to fixate the mind, and there isn't. Whereas religion will tell you, no, there's no way. Give it up. Give it up. Surrender the world. Surrender the universe. I would surrender. I have. I gave up the whole universe today in exchange for just a glimpse of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. I said, my little sister, you know what? You're not appearing to me right now, but okay, I'll tell you what. I will give up the entire universe for you. I'll trade in the whole universe just for a glimpse of you. Okay? And so I'm serious. This is what I'm going to do. Because she's worth more than the entire universe. Just a glimpse of her. To me, see, this is a real devotee spiritual position. Just a glimpse of her, it to me is worth more than the entire universe. And I'm absolutely serious about this. Just a glimpse. Because in that glimpse, you know what you really are. You know what you really are. And the universe really doesn't have anything to do with what you really are. So what value is the universe actually? It's no value at all. But that glimpse is of great value. So Jesus said, give up everything for the pearl of great price. And so I said, yeah, Jesus, I give up the whole universe just for a glimpse of Sri Sri Anandamayi, you know, please. And she'll give it to me. How can she not? When someone's willing to give up the whole universe for her, she has to. She told us this, you know. If you're willing to surrender everything, I got no choice. It's going to happen, you know. So it's going to happen for me. There's no doubt about it. And that's really beyond words. You know, I got mad at her today. I said, look, you know that you're the treasure. And so you're not letting us see the treasure. I mean, how fair is that? That's not fair. That's really unfair. Come on. This universe has no value at all to us. And you do. And you're not letting us see you. That is not fair. So I really got mad at her, which is okay. She tells us to get mad at her because it means that we care. And I'm just yelling at her. I say, come on. I want to see you. I want to see you. And then that's when I said, okay, I'll give up the entire universe for you. Done deal. If that's what it takes, no problem for me. So you see, when people hear that, they say, oh my gosh, I can't give up the whole universe for just a glimpse of a what? That seems too extreme, doesn't it? For me, it's not too extreme at all. Because I've been working at it for so long, and I keep giving up this and this, and it's never enough. And I say, my gosh, what does she want? The world? I gave her the world. That's still not enough. Okay. This is the universe. It's not a big step from giving up the world to giving up the universe, is it? Not really at all. So it's not a big leap to do that. And, you know, you can give up... okay. You can give up, you know, most of the world. That's not so difficult, right? Because most of us say, I don't need it. So progressively, I give up more and more and more and more of the world. Finally, I said, okay, give up the whole world. All of it. Peace of God became apparent then. And I'm saying, okay, what do I got to do to get a glimpse of, you know, the saint of saints and give up the whole universe? Okay, for sure, it's worth it, isn't it? Absolutely is worth it. And that would help. If anybody here in this world really gets a glimpse of the saint of saints, that has to help everybody. Has to. Because there'll be a certain kind of confidence here, and we need that type of confidence. We need that type of confidence because people are going to lose their confidence, and they think it's irretrievably gone. And then they're going to hear some voice that just has the confidence, and they say, oh my gosh, somebody has it, so it must not be totally lost. You know, I don't know where I misplaced it temporarily. You know, I'll find it again. And it's like that. So, yeah, I'm super confident. And I'm just getting used to that, super confident. That's what I was born for. I've always been this way. I said, no, I'm going to make it. I'm going to help out. I want to help the world out. Because it needs the help. You know, if you can, everybody who can really must help out at this time. And use in whatever way they can. You know, whatever way you can help out, really be helpful. I saw a lot of stuff today. It's just, wow. A lot of interference. You know, it's a bad, bad scene right now. I don't want to talk about specifics because people are going to feel, you know, riled up by it. You know, in hindsight, we'll see it. And I've said it in previous videos. I've laid it out pretty well. And probably lost a lot of viewers because of it. I don't want to lose the rest of the viewers, you know. Thank you for those of you who are hanging in there. It's really great. It's going to get better and better and better and better and better. And you know, you'll be better for it. Because you're in touch with someone that really has super confidence. And that's going to show up at some point. You know, yeah, I'm still rattled because just the obligation when you see what I've seen, you feel an obligation. And a responsibility to say, oh my gosh, I've really got to step up. And so, of course, it rattles you. So I'm still, you know, rattled and shaky and nervous and all this kind of stuff. But it's a good feeling. I like it. You know, it's like, okay, great. There'll be a lot of conflict in the world, you know, just between neighbors, just the stuff that they've been told to me. People are telling me stuff now constantly, just saying like, and keep in mind, the world set me free. The world set me free. And maybe one of the few in this world that have been set free. The world, I didn't set myself free of the world, so to speak. The world set me free. And said, we trust you, go to the Dharma Kings, get help for us, we need help. We know you won't abandon us. And so they set me free. So I have some sort of carte blanche here in some way, you know, because it's a different story. It's not like I defeated the world or something like, no, the world said, okay, you can go. Go, you're free of us. And they honestly did so. And I walked away from the world and I went to the Dharma King and said, okay, what can we do to help the world? And they told me, just promise us you'll come back with some sort of help. And I said, okay, we'll do everything we can. I will. So it's a pretty, you know, interesting situation. I've never heard it put that way before. Whereas the world decides to set you free because they trust you. Because the world here, these people are you know, really, really struggling in the swamp of hope and fear, badly, badly. We call them very psychotic. All these defenses trying to stabilize hallucination makes you psychotic. It really does. So everybody's weird here, pretty much so. They have this weirdness to them, this edge to them, and you know, you really can't get through it. It doesn't really work. It only works through losing interest in it, you know, losing interest in doubt, and then getting familiar with confidence and certainty. That's the only way out of this terrible psychosis that we're in, is interest. What are you interested in? You can't just think your way out of it. You cannot. You cannot educate yourself out of it. It's impossible. That's why it takes so much patience. You can't just go take classes and notes and say, I got it. It never will never work that way. It'll never work that way. You really have to make it your vocation and your purpose in life and work at it from the level of familiarity. And that will steadily lead you out of it, out of the trouble. So don't ever approach it from that conceptual, intellectual, cleverness standpoint, okay? And I mean any of the cleverness. Approach it from an honest standpoint. Realize I have a familiarity problem, a very severe familiarity problem, and that's it. Nothing other than that. Nothing other than that. And then just focus on that, and that's how to succeed. Don't let your focus go anywhere else. I don't care who's saying what. You just say, I have a very, my problem is a very severe familiarity problem, and that is it. I don't have any other problem. And that is guaranteed to work for you and work brilliantly for you. And you can do it in one lifetime. Most definitely. Once you come across that and realize that is true, and this is it, this is my path, then the path is, you know, you're going to have a tremendous success along the way. And get there, you know, quite quickly, actually. But, you know, one lifetime is actually quite very quick, very quick. And you might even do it, you know, within a period of a lifetime if you're really exceptional. But we don't want to, you know, put too much pressure on anyone. But just say one lifetime. You really can do it. When you see the only problem I have is a continuity problem, a familiarity problem, same thing. That's it. That's it. And this means I'm used to being interested in doubt, and I'm not used to being interested in certainty. So, what do you do under those circumstances, right? That's a tricky thing. So then this requires, when you realize that's your problem, then you start employing skillful means, and you start become open and recognize, oh my gosh, this really works. This bridge of wow works, where you take on this temporary identity of my identity is wow. It's wow. And so then you're able to stabilize yourself as you move your comfort zone more towards certainty. You can always say, well, I'm stable in the wow. And you're no longer that egoic identity or that hope and fear identity. You're the wow identity now. And you're not yet the peace of God identity, okay? You're this bridge identity. This is the secret of it. And it really, 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 really works. thank God that I was able to, you know, recognize all this just through, you know, massive, steady determination. I said, I know there's a way. I know there's a way. And I'm going to, you know, I will come across it for sure. But, you know, it's easier said than done because it's a familiarity issue. That's why the patience is necessary. You might think, okay, I get it conceptually. That's the ego says, I got it. It doesn't have anything. What's it got? A concept. A picture. So what? That doesn't do much of any. It doesn't do anything to the familiarity issue problem we have. It does. It really doesn't touch upon it. That's kind of like, you know, saying, "What do I take? I got a problem, doctor." Doctor says, "Oh, take some aspirin." You know, oh, okay. And he says, "I got it." And then you don't go get the aspirin. You don't take the aspirin. I mean, you still got the headache, is what you got. Still got. That's what you. You got the name. You got a label, aspirin. But you don't actually take the aspirin. It's like that. But we're so afraid. We're so insecure about the peace of God, thinking that that's an abyss. It's an abyss. Falsely, using false logic, you know, we come to that conclusion. Falsely. And so it's very scary to look at that. I realize that very few of you have been able to look at that. It's, you have to really know how to accept that you're the wow. You're the wow. And that's it. So when you see it, you just say, well, wow. That's the only reaction you have. The hope and fear, you don't pay any attention to how it reacts. Now, it'll kick up in nightmares, which has been happening to me. That is definitely true. And that's not easy. But you just keep going back to wow. You know, just, I am the wow. And how do I feel? Wow. What do I think? Wow. What are my reaction? Wow. It's only wow. And yet it's full of wow. So it's not like you're small or anything. You feel big. You feel very stable. You feel like a wow guru. You know, I'm the wow guru. You feel that way. Oh, man. We're what is today? The 15th? Man. I think it's the 15th, right? It's got to be. Yeah, it is. Wow, my gosh. Almost halfway through. Basically, we're halfway through March. Getting very close to spring. I think spring's like, what, the 20th? So 16, 17, 18, 19. So I got 4 days. On the fifth day, I got to get my weight down again. Because it went back up about 4 pounds, because I'm under so much stress right now. It's really extremely stressful time for all of us. It may be the most intense that we've seen. And again, I'm experiencing meltdowns in people, trying to help them out. But wow, people are just getting hammered, getting frantic. People are trying to fixate the mind. You know, those who feel that they have to succeed are getting real frantic right now. Maybe they're afraid of Jesus coming back. I think that scares the heck out of a lot of people. Because they wrongly think that God wants us to fixate the mind, and that Jesus wants us to succeed at that. And when Jesus comes back, he's going to say, okay, have you succeeded in fixating the mind yet? And they'll think, everyone will say, oh, I haven't quite done it yet. So they're getting real nervous. Where, of course, that's exactly opposite of the truth. Where Jesus is going to come back and say, okay, have any of you given up trying to fixate the mind yet? And I'll say, well, I'll go with you, Jesus. And they'll say, okay, there you go. In principle, I have. In principle, of course, there's still the echoes and the momentum and, you know, the continuity, familiarity issues are still there. But I recognize the truth of it all. What Jesus said is true. I recognize the truth of it now and how simple it is. So, yeah, I could say, yeah, I'll go with you, Jesus. But The rest of the people are quite nervous, getting because I think the world knows that Jesus is back because he told everybody in 2:15, April of 2:15, he told the whole world. I was witness to it. He informed everybody that he's back, and so this is why right now the world, the last couple years, we've been under this extraordinary strain because we realize, wow, something intense is going to happen. Or, I'm under so much pressure. And most of us are still trying to figure out some way to fixate the mind, which means to fixate hallucination, because we're hallucinating the absence of God is what we're doing, and we think the only safety is to fixate hallucination so it's stable, because we're so used to believing that God is absent, we think God is dead. There's no more God. So if we stop hallucinating, we think it's an abyss. See, this is the trouble we have, and that's a really tough trouble to see and to work through. Very, very difficult. So I got most compassion for everyone. I mean, I don't judge people because they fail. It's like, wow. I mean, succeeding is just very, very difficult. Is this thing still taping? Yeah. It requires, just this intrepid patience and right spiritual mentoring. You have a tremendous dedication. You have to have the right spiritual mentoring. You have to use faith in the right way. You have the grace of God. Must be fully, you must really, really pull it into your life. And, just all this stuff. And if you just neglect all this, then it becomes, prohibitively difficult for sure. Then you're going to find some way to take refuge in some sort of structured fixation, structure, whatever it may be. And there, everybody's offering all these fixation structures in the world, right? Says, here, take refuge here. Here, take refuge here. And they're getting frantic. I gotta get my fixation structure finished quickly, 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 like that. They're under the gun. I'm experiencing this in so many different ways. As for me, it's like, hey, take the universe. Take the universe. Go ahead. I'll surrender the whole universe. Just let me sit at the lotus feet of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. That's all I want. That's a help. That's a big help to the world. We don't have pictures of Jesus, but we do have pictures of Sri Sri Narayana. And you can see, you can do, I mean, for me, I can see right into her spirit, through those pictures. And just, there's nothing you can say. Unstructured. Free mind. It's the mind, it's the spirit, it's what we are, freedom itself, no structure there. She never was structured, tried to fixate her structure, just always just free, just letting it shine, letting the freedom shine. And you just, I can experience it, just tune right into it. So, wow. So I don't know how she can avoid it at this point. She said, she's obligated to devotees. She's, she can't resist. She can't resist. So we'll see how that goes. But I still feel I can still sing. I mean, I feel like singing. I mean, it's happy. It's a nice way to express yourself, and people can relate to it. It's a common denominator. And at some point, when we've all lost our confidence together, the world, they might just say, you know what? Something we're doing just isn't right. And we need to reboot. We need to reboot. I hope, people can get to that. I spoke with someone today and I said, we just got to get to this kindness. People need to be kind to one another. And he said, yeah, either that or build bigger fences. And I said, whoa. He was a structure guy. So he was saying his remedy is to build bigger fences. And I said, you're probably right. They'll probably try that first. And that's what they're doing right now. Everybody's trying to build bigger fences. Okay? In other words, defenses. There's some squabbles, some neighborly squabbles, and I've been aware of and stuff. And not with me, but with other people. And build bigger fences. Now, gender issues are too tough for people to tackle. I can tackle them, but everybody else should not even try at this point, really. They're too tough. Too vicious right now. I got an amazing experience today with that, in that regard. I think it's too amazing to even relate. But this old woman told me something today. She's amazing. She just spoke directly up, and she told me something, and I was like, wow. Her perspective on the genders and stuff, and she was right on the mark. I said, oh my gosh, you're right. It's exactly what I've been seeing, you know. And it's all structured upside down and backwards right now. The whole situation is doomed, you know. It's doomed. The way it's structured right now, it's doomed. And changing that, you know, people are probably going to, you know, if I spoke up, they'd hate me 1,000 times more than they hate Trump, you know, really. Really, they would. They'd mock me, they'd spit at me, they'd hate me. You know, it might not bother me really, but I don't even know if I'm going to do that, actually. Maybe there's a better way. Or, you know, maybe it has to be set right in some way. I don't know. It's so out of whack right now that people are just are going to just, you know, they're just going down with the ship, actually. It's all about trying to structure the mind, okay? And who the leaders say, no, we can do it, we can do it, we can do it. Which, of course, nobody can do it. And, you know, it's a tough pill to swallow to realize you can't do it. And most in the world cannot swallow that pill. And so then there's pragmatic issues that arise of, you know, how to best move, you know, on that familiarity problem, you know, and it's a whole different ball game when you realize you can't do it. Then you get religion, okay, real religion. Right now, the world doesn't have that. They're trying to eradicate religion. They think that the religion's the problem. That religion telling us that we can't structure it, that's the problem. And that if we just get rid of religion, they'll get real confident, and then they'll be able to find the secret to structuring the mind. And this is, you know, totally false. There's no way to structure the mind. God, we're an idea in the mind of God, and the mind of God is absolute freedom. And there's no structure, or no way to structure absolute freedom at all. If you really consider it, it's impossible. You're always perfectly free every instant. How can you structure what you are? In other words, how can you define what you are? You cannot. So all those who have, you know, now have taken the lead in saying, hey, we can do it. We can structure it. Just listen to us. Follow our lead. We'll get you there. You know, blind leading the blind. Blind leading the blind into a dark hole. So that can't stand. You know, that cannot stand going forward. It has to be changed. It has to collapse. It has to be restructured back to religious culture, saint-based religious culture, because saints showcase to us that the peace of God is not an abyss, and you can get there. And then you gradually start building faith. You have to have faith on the path, and you have to know how to use faith. So the world, in its effort to get rid of faith, to get rid of religion, and all this stuff, is doomed to drastic failure. Totally doomed. I can see this without any doubt whatsoever. This is a fact. So restructuring will have to take place, and I don't know how that's going to take place, because those that are, you know, have the power now, culturally, socially, gender-wise, as far as we know how to structure the mind. They don't want to give it up, and they don't know where to go. I mean, so you know, how that's going to play could be really, really quite a lot of tears, you know. But it has to be done at some point. sooner better than later. Yeah, it has to go back to what it used to be, is saint-based culture. People have to have access to saints. The children have to be taught about saints and taught that they have the right to have access, and this is the right thing to do. And we have to have a religious education from cradle to grave about how to use faith properly and the virtues of patience and realizing that we're sinners. I mean, we have this familiarity problem. That's what it means to be a sinner, and it's extremely severe. We're out of whack with God. We're trying to separate ourselves from God. This world is an attempt to separate ourselves from God, trying to stabilize hallucination. It's the play of hope and fear. That is not what, you know, this is, you know, a side trip into fear, really, for us. It's fear-based. We need liberation. We need salvation. The grace of God is present to help us. All this stuff has to be fundamentally educated in children. It has to be, or else there's just no way that people are going to make it. You know, I had this education. I mean, I made a point of it. I had to educate myself, but at least my dad was very much, very strong in all of this. He's very much a very high yogi from previous lives, a yogin. And the Christian culture and the Bay Area culture at that time, growing up, allowed a diversity of religions. I was extremely ecumenical. You know, my grandmother. On one side was Science of Mind, the other side was Christian Science. One of my grandmothers was quite brilliant spiritually, very, very, very mystical, high mystical person. And I had access to all of that, and then I made sure that all of my focus and attention was put on the saints in my life. That's all I've ever really focused on, is saints and faith. This is what it takes. This is what it takes. Otherwise, the absolute simplicity of it all will not dawn upon us, and we'll still fear the peace of God, and we'll still be struggling to try and get somehow some structure to the mind, which is just stalling out, really. Speaking about stalling out, go back to surfing. Give us a little break here. Man, just to see John Florence surfing again after this break, winter break, where the surf tour is over, that was exciting. Man, did he surf great. I just like, holy cow, I love how he surfs. It's just darn, you know, I just, it's like the role model for surfing right now. You just realize that he's just, you know, best surfer in the world, plain and simple. And it just looks great, you know, doing it. So I was thrilled. I saw his heat live, you know, I saw it from Australia. I saw his heat. It's just, oh my gosh. I mean, he never fell, and he's just doing these maneuvers that you think he's for sure he's going to fall. It's so radical. He's sitting back in the water and just covered up, and he still comes out of it. And I said, God, oh my, there he goes, you know. He's better than ever. And his coach, he has a new coach who's my namesake, has the same first name. So someone with my first name, Ross, is coaching the greatest surfer in the world right now. I said, I thought that's pretty cool. I said, that's a good omen. That's a good omen for me, you know, somehow. It really is. And that news just came out a couple days ago. I said, holy cow. I like that. So you don't see my name very often, and to see that the best, greatest surfer in the world, that's his coach now. I said, yeah. Oh, what a fortunate guy he is to be coaching, you know, a guy like John Florence, who's really, I like him. I like his personality. He's very well-spoken and humble. And just, you know, I get a good vibe from the guy. I really do. He's a really good ambassador for surfing. Much like Kelly Slater has been for a long time. And, you know, it's a beautiful thing to see him surf. You just say, wow, that would be fun to be able to surf like that. And somebody invited me to go surfing today. I saw this guy and I said, man, you look like a surfer. You know, you really look like a surfer. And I know this guy. And he didn't say anything. And later on, I talked about surfing again. And he said, oh, I just went surfing yesterday. I said, what? You surf? He goes, oh, yeah, I'm a surfer. I said, I knew you were a surfer. I could just tell. I said, you should be a surfer, you know. And he said, oh yeah, I surf. I surf a lot. I love surfing. And he said, I'll have to go surfing sometime. And I said, I can't see anything without these glasses. You know, you laughed. Yeah, but who knows, you know. I don't know what they do. Goggles. If it's meant to happen, it'll meant to happen. But I you know, I'm tuning into surfing and learning the lingo and stuff. It'd be kind of fun. It'd be kind of fun to do it again and to be able to do it more consciously instead of just trying to survive as a kid. You know, just to feel like, okay, I'm a little bit more aware of the whole of the situation. Who knows? But, you know, seeing the very best at something, that's fun. I enjoy that. Because there's a flow to it and a confidence to it. You just feel the confidence and flow to it. And, you know, it picks your spirits up. Somebody is really confident, which is great. Because we're all, you know, struggling. I'm under a lot of time pressure is what it is, as far as, you know, I have to move really fast, really, really fast. So I'm waking up at 3 a.m, which I shouldn't do anymore, because I'm so stunned, I can't do anything. I just lay awake, I can't really focus. It's just so difficult. Everything is so stunning now, isn't it? The harshness of polarization right now. The hardening of people's attitudes, the rudeness and hostility towards those who have different opinions, and I can't even really even speak of. If I did, people would just think that I'm being too harsh on them. You know, I'm just trying to stay out of all that stuff, and just move towards singing more. Yeah, I hope I can do that. I don't know if I'll speak up harshly or not. I really don't know, but it's not. It's not harsh, it's just trying to wake people up, but I don't know if they can wake up, actually. And then they'll feel like they're being attacked because they say, I'm too scared to wake up, you know, so don't try to push me, I don't like it. So, you know, they'll go down with the ship, they'll get the white water, you know, they'll get smashed by it, they'll be cast into the ocean, you know, hopefully you get them in the lifeboats. And if musicality comes upon me, I know I can do it. I've experienced it many times where I just, you know, get in the groove and boom, that's it. It's like a light goes on. And, you know, I can just groove. But other, you know, rest of the time, you know, I'm not in a groove because, you know, that's fine. But I know I've done it so many times. I know I can do it if that's what God wants. You know, say, okay, you know, stay in the groove. I say, well, okay, let's just stay groove. It's like getting barreled in surfing. You just stay barreled for a long time. Some of these guys can do that too. I mean, some of the barrels they have are just amazing. How they can, you know, they're so confident, relaxed. They know how to push the speed, and then they know how to stall out in the barrel too. They know how to just manage their speed perfectly. With awareness, so they can just stay in it, just on the edge of getting wiped out, and then finally emerge from it, and it's just like, wow, that's a lot of skill there, a lot of awareness. As musicality is like that, you get in the groove, and people can just feel you're in the groove, and you just don't come out of it, and then they keep feeling like, wow, you know, they're still in the groove, you know, this is really amazing. If you just stay in it, it's just like, ah, clap, clap, clap. Yeah, that's great. Because everybody likes to be in that groove, musical groove, you know, there's some kind of groove, right, where you just know you can do no wrong. You're just feeling it. That's what musicians, that's why it's so addictive to them. Because they find the groove occasionally, and they keep searching for it. And it's very addictive. Because it's an experience that you feel you can do no wrong. And isn't that what we're looking for? It's just, you feel unstructured for a while. When I get in the groove, it's like there's no structure to my mind anymore. And I can sing in any direction. Just be in a groove. It doesn't matter anything. I can just do anything. And it's all it's all good. It's all wowish. So where's the structure? It's in the moment. It's just in the flow of ornamentation of the moment. You know, that's all that it is. And you let go. You're constantly letting go of what you just did. You can't fixate on what you just did, then you're out of the groove. So you just have to have this feeling that no matter what you do, it's great. And so you don't need to fixate on what you just did, because what you're doing right now is just great, and what you're going to do is just great. You don't need to fixate in the future or the past. You just stay right in the now. So singing enables me to really practice staying in the now. As soon as you get the expectations involved in singing, forget it. But then you also have to realize the familiarity issue and go into the wow. When you've been successful with it, purposefully go decide, I'm going back into the wow identity right now, and let me just take a breather. This happened to me yesterday. Put on the CD, The Wanderer by Dion's first song, and it started, I just started singing, just boom! I was feeling great, a lot of energy, I just was feeling it, and I just absolutely nailed it right off the bat, and I was just punching it. I was right there with him, and suddenly I said, oh my gosh, what am I doing? And then I said, I better go into the wow, so I went right into the wow. I stopped singing and just started wowing. I said, wow. Wow, do I have it today? That kind of thing. And so I backed off of it. Just say, okay, I've got it. So I don't need to keep singing. Let me just get used to the fact I've really got it. See, that's wisdom. Don't, when you feel like, oh my gosh, I'm in the flow, I'm really in the flow, go into the wow. And so what happened was, later on, then I went back and spent the whole day singing. Whereas if I had just tried to just, you know, not gone into the wow and kept singing, I could have gotten overwhelmed by it all and burned out. But instead, I was able to sing the whole day because I took a step back. I took a step back and said, let me just let this sink in. Let me let this sink in for a little while, that like, okay, today is going to be an extraordinary day. I realized that. So let me just adjust my expectations that today is going to be an extraordinary day. And once I had adjusted my expectations and calmed down with it, then, you know, it became an extraordinary day. I was able to, you know, to ride that wave, to surf that wave, the wave of the extraordinary day. Carve it, you know, beautifully. You see the surfers doing that. I noticed that. They take stock. They take a little break on the wave sometimes. And they see what's coming up, and they'll kind of like, they'll steady themselves, they'll steady the expectations. They say, okay, wow, this is going to be a wow wave. But let me just kind of surf normally, just right here, right now. And then, okay, here we go. And then they start jamming down the line, you know, and just, you know. And that's, I'm noticing that. They give themselves this little breather, you know, to peace, to calm them. And these guys are the top surfers in the world, and they know how to do. They know how to calm themselves. They know how to manage their nerves and their expectations and stuff. They have to get to this point and be really successful. So if they see it, say, oh my gosh, this wave is lining up beautifully. They don't. You could see that they just kind of just momentarily steady themselves on the board. And they're just surfing normally, just kind of taking it really easy, not doing anything. They're just taking a break from all the maneuvers and everything. They just take a little break. And then hit the pedal. Put the pedal to the metal. Accelerate. So before you accelerate too much, take a break in the wow. So you may come out accelerating great, and then you say, oh my gosh, I've got it today. Step back, take a break in the wow, and just say, okay, today my identity is going to be the wow identity. That's my identity for the day. And I'm really in the wow, as you might be able to tell. And I'm not taking enough break. You know, it's not easy, because you get pretty excited about your life and your expectations. Say, oh my gosh, my life is going to be amazing, you know. Well, yeah, but then take a step back and just be like normal for a little bit. And let your, you know, settle down into the new set of expectations. Don't push it. My nerves are pretty jittery. I mean, I just have to trust, you know, trust in the WoW that will calm it down. Because when you get the kind of clarity I've had, then you start thinking, oh boy, you know, what could be next? It sure isn't any more clarity, you know, about the path, you know. So it's going to be something else. Don't really know what. Now that's pretty exciting. There's something that Kelly Slater said again. They said, how you feeling? This may be your last chance. You can go for one more title, number 12. And then you said, you know, this was probably your last year. And he said, yeah, probably is. And I decided I'm going to go for it, and this is it. And he said, I feel great. I feel relaxed. I feel great because I committed, and I know in my mind what I'm going to do, and there's a lot of pressure on me, but I feel that I'm in the context, the right context. I made a decision. So I said, it's better that you do that. That you decide, okay, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go all in and see how it goes. That's it. And, you know, if I don't contend for a title or don't win one, then I'm going to walk away. I'm going to walk away. He said, if I win another title, I might try another one because I realize I'm still able to do it. But if I don't make it, he says, it's very likely, you know, you've seen the last of me. And he got beat in his first heat today by Mick Fanning. He surfed great, but he just didn't get the right waves, the high enough scores, you know, the wave selection. He just couldn't quite get the high enough scores. And but there's nothing wrong with his surfing. It was very good, as usual. It's tough to win heats, you know, surfing. It really is tough. And, you know, it's about the maneuvers, especially the first couple of maneuvers you do. They have to be really, really, they're looking for real power maneuvers. This is what I'm seeing. And the guys are just, you know, go all out to just throw some really radical stuff right away on the wave. And then from there, see if they can, you know, carve it up from there and string together, you know, lots of maneuvers. But you really have to start off powerfully. That's what scores points. If you don't do that, and you just kind of throw in a bunch of maneuvers on a wave, that doesn't score so highly. It has to, they have to be extremely strong maneuvers that you're right on the edge of just thinking, wow, you know, this looks like you're not going to make it, and you have to make it. And that's what they're doing. And I realized that, holy cow. I mean, they're getting their fin drift, you know, severe fin drift, and getting in the white water on the maneuvers, just and coming out of it, and you know, just doing stuff that is really super edgy, and making it, and so that's what the judges are looking for to score highly. You have to be really risky and make it, and this is the pressure these guys are under. I mean, Slater tried to do this incredible 360, and he just missed it. If he had made it, he probably would have won the heat, but he missed it. He fell. He just had to go for it. And so you have to make it. it's like, wow, yeah, these guys really have to be great, don't they, to not fall, to make it. And some of the other guys I saw, they were falling. They were trying this stuff, but they just kept falling. I mean, the pressure is so severe on them, the rookies, that they fell. Because they knew they were competing with these like John Florence, they're competing with him. They had to try to do super radical stuff and make it. And they weren't making it. They were falling and getting real low scores because of it. So We're in a situation right now where we need to get high scores, you know, so I'm like going, making really radical breakthroughs, great breakthroughs, and making it, you know, staying on the board like that as far as clarity about, wow, what, you know, the mind and what's really going on in the world, what's really going on. Most are not reading it properly at all. very confused reading from most in the world about what's going on. And again, religious culture is all important. All important. Religious freedom is all important in the world. That's what's really going on. That's what's truly important. And they're trying to eradicate religion from the world, actually. This is the real battle in the world. People don't see that at all. Not many. I mean, some religious conservatives see it, not quite as clearly as I see it. They don't understand how severe it is, actually. But some are kind, you know, they at least they're saying, wow, this isn't good. And they're aware, you know, from the standpoint of prophecy, that this is what was prophesied to happen in the Bible, exactly what this prophesied is happening. It's an all-out war to eradicate religion, or the religious culture, from this planet. Because again, wrongly, they believe that there is a way to structure the mind, and religion is getting in the way of that. So religion is causing fear on the planet and conflict. That's what they say. And they're totally wrong. It's exactly the opposite. It's the attempt to fixate that's causing insecurity and war, fear and war and conflict and stuff. That's what's causing it. And the people, they blame, you know, the wars on religion. Well, no, it's the people who don't get the religion. They claim to be religious, but they don't understand it. Those are the ones that cause the problem. And you might even say they're subversives, actually, right? If you understand religion, you're not going to cause wars and conflict, not at all, not at all. You're going to be very kind, very forgiving. You're not going to hold grudges at all. You know, what's done is done, leave it in the past, and it's finished, you know, and you're going to move on with compassion and all. You're going to be, religion is really what makes peace in the world. They're the true peacemakers. So the demonization of religious culture is very, very false, actually. So false. They've got it backwards. Look how the Tibetans handled, you know, being driven out of Tibet and the cultural genocide there. And, you know, they've handled it so amazingly well, I don't even know what to say. I really shouldn't say anything because, you know, it's beyond words how their compassion, you know, and forgiveness and refusal to hold grudges and all this is just, it puts us all to shame, actually. And that shows you what a great religious culture is all about. And it's a saint-based culture, totally. It's the best saint-based culture I've ever come across. I mean, the Lama, you know, is sacrosanct. They revere their gurus. It's really guru yoga there. And they have so much faith in their gurus. And you know, it's just, it's astonishing, really. And I want to say something for sure. Just to set the record straight about the Chinese and the Han Chinese, I love the Chinese people. Okay, they're very lovable people, and I don't, you know, I'm not trying to, you know, put them down. I'm just saying that religious freedom in the world is all important. So, but what's happened is the world wants to, the materialistic attitude of the world wants to get rid of religion, thinking it's impinging upon their materialism, because they think materialism, if we just structure, which is a structure, if we just structure it properly, we'll all be happy. So, you know, they've demonized religion, say, you know, you're getting in the way of our happiness. If you were gone, we'd have this materialistic utopia. So we need to get rid of you. And so they've really invited the Han Chinese and sided with them, saying, hey, you guys, come on, help us get rid of religion. So if people said, no, we want to keep religion, then the Han Chinese would be contained. They'd be contained. They wouldn't be invited to do so. So unfortunately, we've invited them to, you know, be the way that they seem to be right now. And they're just, so there, it takes two to tango. And so I really can't blame them. The blame should not be put on them. It should be, it's plenty of blame to spread around everyone in the world, right? That is trying to get rid of religion. And the Han Chinese have shown they're very good at that, right? They're the experts at that. They've wiped out religion in China and basically prohibited it, right? I mean, you cannot profess anything other than the communist line there, really. You can't profess any religious belief, or else you're going to a gulag somewhere, if you're lucky. So, there's a few propaganda showcase things at the pop, but that who are they fooling? Religion. And the world has invited them. The world is actually helping them out, aiding them, and saying, yeah. A lot of America is helping them out, actually. Get rid of religion. And, I'm not going to hate anybody, because I'm all the time. There's so many Chinese people in the Bay. And I like them, You can say I love everybody in the world. I love them, and they love me. I don't have any problems. I've never had any problems from China. So that's not the issue. It's not, hating people is not the issue at all. It's religious freedom, and the absolute. That's the number one issue in the world. It's the most in the world. Freedom of speech really means it means freedom of religion. To have diverse religions in the world, and because people have different ways of trying to structure the mind, which means, walk that back the way they walk. Since there's different styles of that, you need different religions, different styles, walk it back. It's obvious. So we cannot have one world religion. That's not going to happen. And we don't want anyone to dominate the world. We want this pluralism and coexistence with this person. And sure, it's not easy to do that. It's ragged, right? Of course, it's what has to be done. You cannot impose a particular style on everybody. It's not going to ever happen, really. Jesus has his style. I understand his style and I understand what he was, what it's about. People that doesn't work. And Tibetan Buddhism has a style work. Yeah, so I understand that. Style is exactly his ecumenical style. It's sort of a blended Course in Miracles, of course, but also Buddhist style and Vedanta style of those styles with some mysticism in it. It's just sort of a ecumenical particular style too. Came from music, listening to all different to become a better musician. You tend to be okay in listening habits. I listen. I listen to anything that's really great. I want to hear what are they doing there? What's this? And so, as a musician, I think that's why I became very spiritually. I'm a minimalist spiritually. So I'm comfortable in any religion, actually. Totally comfortable because I like to blame all of them. So I don't feel particularly to any of them, actually. But that's okay because walking the path back is ultimately you go beyond to the peace of God. And I, of course, with this life, a real powerful influence was Yogananda, who was very ecumenical. It may have been a weightism, but he's, nickel. The spirit was, I felt the spirit was maybe he put the, Hinduism at a higher plane or to Jesus. So, yeah, Jesus is also like this, and, but it was helpful. It's helpful, just to that, yeah, we can get along, and so I've just, spread it out, broadened it to really, just all different paths. There's many. Because there's many different ways we've tried to structure the mind, many different styles, and when you get familiar with that style, you got to stay in with the style to walk it back. You can't just flip in. The familiarity doesn't really allow that. Feel then weird if you try to do that. It doesn't work. So people who tried sacrifice to structure the mind, you need Jesus to focus on. One sacrifice gets people to lose their sacrifice. It's just like one thought helps us lose interest in all their thoughts. But Christ Jesus helps with those and that sacrificial. To lose all interest in all other sacrifice, and then it's the point. Then they're able to lose interest in sacrifice, Jesus sacrifice, and then they're done with sacrifice, and that will to really get back to the peace of God. Did is he came to us a cultures who are super into sacrifice. I'll give you one sacrifice that'll help you interest in all the other ones, and then from that point, then ultimately you'll lose interest in that sacrifice too. And then that'll get, that's just one particular style of teaching who had this obsession fix with sacrifice. It was really a nasty, nasty, to say the least. You know, ancient times, if you look into it, you know, it's like, wow, how, really? What the, what, to fixate the mind? I mean, you go into some verses with hope and fear, and you're insecure into that. You believe that you must fixate the mind, you're going to feel sturdy, because you can't. You're always going to feel slip up away from the whole thing falling apart. Some very weird behavioral patterns. And so that's why you have these different styles in the world. Religions to, you know, to walk it back. And like, you know, a lot of those, that stuff they were into, of all sorts of mental fixations into people. So Buddhists were trying all these meditative ways to fixate the mind. So Buddha came in and helped them. It's not meditation, and it's not, you know, trying to discipline the body through asceticism, sacrificial style. So Buddhism doesn't really train in a sacrificial style, you know, but Jesus doesn't really train them very well at all, actually. Doesn't need to. Now, for me, I love aesthetics and beauty, and trying to music. If we could just get this musical flow, that's it's like a sort of a lightly fixated mind. I have to walk it back in a subtle way. So I kind of need help from the gurus. It's I'm able to be very abstract and say, let's just light fixation. That means let's gently fixate it and let's do it. You know, beauty. I'm very much into beauty. So let's see if we can fixate the mind. So I'm not really. I've never was into try to fixate it through sacrifice, or these into the ritual, any kind of ritual. Nothing that it was just for me to fixate the mind. Let's look at this perfect sunset. You know, maybe that can help us. Let's look at these. Let's listen to this beautiful music. Maybe that can help us. Beautiful clothing and tapestry and beauty, gorgeous beauty, sublime beauty. That's how I am. That's how my mind is. Either it's very frustrating. Caught up in stress, nervous breakdowns, and stress are the problem, because you try to be creative, more and more creative. You think, I just like poetry. If I just get the right poetry, you know, that's it. Or just put this poetry to music. That's it. This is the struggle that, you know, some of us have. They're not many, but there's certainly some, you know, they're well, compared to the others, I don't know what the percentage is, like that. It is, let's say, more ecumenical, more, because we'll take beauty wherever we get it, you know, about, is it Buddhist beauty or Christian beauty? It doesn't make any difference to us at all. If I see, oh, that's so beautiful. You know, and sectarianism at all. See something beautiful in Christianity. Beautiful, thank you so much. So I'll do wherever I get it. And same with music, you know, whatever, across the board, wherever I get it. So I don't have this sectarian, which I would say, an advantage. And but it causes you also to try and, you know, you think you can get it, and you don't get it. Oh, this is so much better, this path. And yet it's a problem. It's the same problem. And it's very frustrating. And you tend to be very disciplined, like, if I just sing better, maybe that's it. Better, maybe that's it. If my poetry is just better, that's it. If I just dance better, maybe that's it. If I could just come dancing and the singing and the music and the poetry, maybe that's jing. And maybe we do it out in nature at sunset by the ocean. Maybe that's it. Yeah. And women and song, you know, maybe if it's just all the aesthetics, the mind will say, oh, okay, I'm willing to be fixated like this because it's so beautiful. No. That's the, you know, it's the same. It's the same. So, you know, it's a tough, very frustrating. Tough to see through that. Any path you have is difficult. But that's why we need a plurality of religions in the world. Is the people we've really taken, that there's many divergent ways we can struggle and try to sate the mind. And we're so familiar with trying that we can approach that works within the context of what otherwise it won't work. So that's why Buddha came in, his path, and then Jesus came in, his path. Dhamma came in and gave his path. There's some people really adept at working with energy, subtle energy, try to fixate the mind. That's still imagine. All energies are imagination, actually. And so that Vipassana brought in the tantric path, where they really work on Anattara yoga, the subtle energy channels, the mind, sounds, mantras, all inner sort of work of visualization and sounds. And it's another way of trying to fixate the mind. Different than the trance states of, like the, of the Buddhism, trying to meditate into trance states and stuff. That's different. So Tibetan Buddhism is a particular path also for those who the mind in that way, working with subtle energy. So I don't relate to that at all. This, yeah, I don't have a problem with that. And I, thinking that, hey, I can fixate the mind by some little winds and channels and energies and chakras and lights and all the, or even, thought about any of that stuff, really, it didn't resonate with me at all. So it's not a problem. Same with meditation. Meditation is really not. It's a problem for those who've spent a lot of time fixate the mind through meditation, then it's a big problem. But my problem comes from just, entertainment and beauty, beautiful entertainment and seeing, stuff. I said, maybe, we could do this and that, that'll work. I can dream up just fabulous entertainment, my mind. Just fabulous stuff. So beautiful. I mean, everyone's in tears. Easy for me. Gorgeous ceremony, concerts, and just spirit, spiritual upliftments of just beauty, and people are just, they're just, overwhelmed by it all and just crying. Beautiful. I can just do that endlessly, but that's not the peace of God. It's not. Can it be helpful at some point? Yeah, maybe meditation could be helpful for some people. I mean, be careful. Careful. We don't want to get back into sacrifices, do we? No. I'm still doing that. Let's sacrifice 1,000 animals, and they may get back into that. Actually, coming up in the world, it's very possible. Some people are sacrificing human beings in warfare right now. A sacrifice can be a very broad brush, and actually, for me, romanticism. Really one of the big kingpins of romanticism. And the romantic aesthetic beauty, really just people feeling, soulfulness, in terms of aesthetics. Very, very keen into tuned into aesthetics, and they'll see a flower and beautiful to them. Very in that. It's just, I just find it to be, wow. The atmosphere, the flowers and the lush foliage and all this stuff. I get carried away. You just want to sing and dance and just yourself in it, which is pretty. It's all this stuff has some bit in some way. I mean, there's tinges of it, of freedom there, and we can't really get away from it. But not everybody relates to that. I realize that. I post some of these videos, and very few people respond. It's like, wow. Because they're too, like, they might be into different sacrificial notions or meditational notions or and well, notions of right ritual, building beautiful structures. That's another thing to that. So they had them build cathedrals, build some here, build a beautiful cathedral. A lot of builders. That's another thing there, and they have their, for instance, have their own kind of own religion, actually. There's all sorts of secrets to Templars, Knight Templars, these, who have their, this really type of religions, how to walk back from what, how they tried to fixate reality, the mind. So yeah, I'm tolerant to all those, I see the beauty tends to be quite tolerant. It's a problem though. You get some beauty with someone, but they're beautiful, or something. You can sing beautifully. I don't care if you're, a troublemaker. Careful about that. That's not good. You have to have more dharmic recognition. take refuge in the wow. You know, take refuge. And for me, like Sri Sri Ananda, my greatest beauty I've ever seen, just, you know, the vibe that she puts in words. It's imperceptible. She has imperceptible beauty. That's what I feel. For me, that's very helpful. I just, this is more beautiful than the whole. She has higher beauty than that. She has imperceptible beauty. And so I can't resist that, you know, for me. The peace of God is imperceptible beauty, really. Everything, really. Softness and gentleness and glory, imperceptible glory. Perceptible glory, and yet we can feel it. We can experience it. Where it's an awareness, a felt experiencing of it. It's a total. You say, wow, it's imperceptible. But not everybody responds to that. I'm always surprised. What? Yeah, you know. So they have a different style. They're into find some way to control my mind through, you know, subtle meditation or trying to fixate through trance state. Beauty is not an issue for them, you know, so much. But for one who's highly, you know, step Sri Sri Ananda Mayama, you know, just their ambience, you know, whatever it is, just stuns us into silence. It's just, can't say anything. Because it goes beyond perception. There's nothing full as this. Nothing. It transcends, her beauty transcends the universe, actually. This is a fact. The beauty that is there transcends the universe. Body's just an empty hull, you know. It was just of God with a, you know, hull or husk around it, basically. A very transparent husk. That's all it was. And so you just say, oh, and the body being there just gave us a way to kind of stabilize ourselves in the wow. We could really then relate very to the peace of God directly. Very direct means to the peace of God, but very stressful. I mean, I've been working on it for, and it's very stressful because it just knocks you out. Just aesthetically knocks you out if you're disposed that way. So we don't need any more sacrifice. The path has Jesus. Okay, one sacrifice, a sacrifice. Okay, on that path of sacrifice, you know, hey, no more sacrifice. Okay, be peaceful. And love one another. We have our one sacrifice. We don't need any more. That's our path for you. It'll work for you. Christianity works for people who on that path. I never quite understood. See, it works. Because once you give up, if you fixate the mind and you give up all sacrifice, ultimately, and they give up even Jesus' sacrifice, then you're there. You're there. You know? And the peace of God will be upon many Christians. The peace of God. Actually, so amazing path. I mean, I don't relate to it too well, but I have to say it has worked for many Christians very well. So let's share. No way. Let's not get any of these religions, actually. Oh, let's cherish them all. Let's cherish them all, and you know it that it works for, and they need it. They need it. So these people, boy, are they causing trouble in this world? Don't know what they're doing. They're tech-driven. Say, no. Computers will be, you know, technology to fixate the mind. And there's no ability of that ever happening. Zero. Okay? God's will can't be changed. Absolutely free. You cannot fixate it at all. Do it. So they're barking up the wrong tree. Barking up the wrong tree. And, you know, we don't have that tree. You know, we have, we're not interested in barking up that. It's a no. You know, and say what you want. We're not. We know better. You know, you cannot mock and pull us down. We are firm in our convictions and our clarity about what works, what we have to do. And just because we're with it doesn't make it wrong. It means it's difficult. Familiarity issues are very difficult to deal with. It's ragged. The path is ragged, and you have to put up with that raggedness. It's another thing that I'm really good at. I mean, as a musician, I didn't really care about how I looked or things see in my house, you know, it didn't matter if I got the great music with me. It's whatever people think. I don't care about any of that stuff. So I you know, ragged is fine. So I'm very, very okay with that, because the spiritual path is very ragged. If you try to make it totally smooth and try, you it's up and down. I mean, you be road. I'm okay with bumpy roads to bother me. Some people, they can't stand. What are those bumps? What are that? You know, they want to me. Just, I don't care. My mind's, you know, look at this. Oh, it's so beautiful. I don't care about the bumps. And so that's very helpful. If you can't be too fast on the path, you cannot be overly fastidious about stuff. It's familiarity problem back, you know, into no, you know, maybe the, you know, this looked like it was promising, you know, why that, you know, behind, because I said, because nothing works. I mean, nothing works, you know, we got to find something. You get lucky, maybe you'll get lucky. Odds are in your favor before, well, that just means the odds are in your favor, and all these pep talk give ourselves, really, it's all nonsense, pep talk. So maybe nonsense, and you have to keep realize, keep, you know, this nonsense. Since there's no way to fixate the mind at all, what are we doing to, you know, look for differences in the various styles, as far as maybe this will work? No, that's not as good as this. What are we doing judging different labels for zero? What does that get us? The study gets us. Maybe this way of doing the better than this way. There's no better to it, because none of it works at all. So you can't, it's absurd. There's no better to it. Zeros against zeros, and wasting our time, wasting life after life in zero and zero. There's no difference. And so, you know, we, it's because we being pulled back into foolishness, and then, you know, we pulled out of it, and we get back. Not easy to stay on track, and no, not for anybody. Not for anyone. So don't lose your confidence just because. That's the difficulty means you probably make a lot of progress. You know, you bring stuff up, you're getting jittery. Well, you're making progress. That means now, because I'm making such fast progress, so I realize I just have to suffer through it. And, you know, yeah, cross. You say, hey, the path. You know, it's so, a lot of jitters. It's not so easy. So for me, I find a lot to like in all of them. I can point out so many great things. Some of them are exactly my style, you know, which is okay. Help from all religions, actually. Religious freedom. Think about that. In this world, just one phrase, religious freedom, is at stake right now in the world. That's the real conflict in this world. That's us, you know, just trying to distract us away. Is many, many people get rid of religion. They don't care about religious freedom at all. In fact, rarely do I come across anybody that cares about religion. They don't exercise it at all. So they don't. If you don't exercise it, you don't care. It's just like if you're not a golfer, bulldoze and turn into homes or whatever. You know, you don't care. Golfer, you'd say you care. I mean, it matters a lot to you. Exercising. Sometimes someone is not exercising freedom of religion to pursue that they're passionate about. That they don't care if freedom of religion is lost, because they're not even interested in religion. I find so many people simply don't care at all anymore. They just don't care. Let the Chinese take over. They don't care. As long as they have materiality, they say, well, maybe the Chinese will, that's great. We'll have more stuff to buy. So the world's empowered China, really. The world built China by obsessionality, right? Buying all this stuff and you know, steal all the secrets and duplicating everything, and to import all that, this stuff, this junk, really, and because they want it. So all that money flowed into the rest of the world, right? So all the power, the money China has, it came from the rest of the world and the materialistic. Let's not blame the Chinese for all of that. It's the world that has empowered the Chinese, actually. So I think that the Chinese are kind of stuck some way. I really see it this way, because the Chinese are good people in their heart. If you win their trust, they're very good people. It really can be. Everyone's that way, you know. The Chinese, yeah. If they, then you're in with them very ethically if you're part, if they feel you're part of their family, but if you're not, your story is really so we have empowered them and pretty much told them, this is what we want you to do. You're really good at this, to do this, and they can't resist. It's like they're caught up in a world. This is how I look at it now. This world, they're so clever at copying stuff and manufacturers at it. And the whole world say, you got to do it. It's your only hope because we got to build this materialistic utopia. And like they're addicts, and they can't stop. And this is the vibe I got today. I was a bunch of Chinese were around me today, and I looked at them, I said, you're wonderful people. And I suddenly realized they're being used by the rest of the world to feed the addiction because they're so talented at it. And they don't, they're like a torrent, and they can't stop themselves. Stopped, actually. They want to be stopped. It's just like if you're really talented at music and people listen, sing for us, you got to do this, you got to do this, you got to do this. Stop, but you can't. You can't stop. And this monster, and I. In addiction, I just can't stop. It's like Dion couldn't stop heroin addiction of rock and roll. I can't stop, God. I want to stop. I can't. And then he just got down on his knees and says, God, you got to help me. You got to do it because I can't. And boom, God did it for him just like that. And he was full rock and roll scene just like that. The heroin, everything did from it. Amazing, amazing. Very worthwhile. That's an artist that's worth paying it. There's really something there. There's a lot of grace there. You don't get that merit of being free by the grace of God unless you have a lot of merit within you through previous lives. He must have had a lot well and have this beautiful vibe, and then to be, that's grace, free him, completely free him from that lifestyle. The whole lifestyle, he was liberated from it. Heroin, the whole lifestyle of using him forward, the rock and roll. That's merit that he had. And I don't, however he got it. I really, really need to be respected there. And like I say, he's for sure one for hurt. Without question. Had to be one heck of a musician and singer in previous life. Something else. And then he became Christian singer. Fantastic singing, Christian singing. Some, heavyweight in Christian history as far as aesthetically. Had to be somehow. This is not right. I'm losing my soul to the music. It got me out. I can't do it. And then God did it for him instantly. That's super high merit, actually. So the Chinese, this vibe from the Chinese, 'cause like I said, the world freed me. They're honest with me. I see the Chinese. They're saying, "Help, help, help, help us. We stop." The world keeps buying all our stuff, pouring money. We destroyed the ecosystem of China already, the countryside doing this, but they keep telling us we need more, we want more, you got to do this for us, this will save us, you're our saviors, you're materialistic saviors, our secular humanist saviors, take over the world. They can't stop, but they want to stop, they want to stop. This is what that I'm feeling because I've been liberated from the world. They said the world set me free to speak their hearts to me, and I can hear what they're really saying is saying, help. Don't really want to do this, but there our talents are in control of us beyond our control. They've gone, we're out of control. We can't control it. The Dion, his musical talent was so great, people were demanding so strong. It became out of his control. He couldn't stop when he wanted to stop. He couldn't stop. Tradition. They want to stop, but they can't stop. But they might, they might. There might be something happened that, they just, we're through with this. But it's the rest of the world demanding all this stuff, consciousness of the world that thinks that, salvation comes from stuff. Those are the ones that the frenzy, they're the ones that arsonists are pouring gasoline on the fire. But China's like a fire, and the rest of the world's pouring gasoline on the fire, saying more stuff. So happen in the world that could change the whole dynamic of this, and people suddenly say Chinese, and they'd say, you know what? Thank you. We're sick of it too. We know it's not the answer. It's just we couldn't. So this is a totally new way of looking at global. Totally new way. It's driven by compassion. I just saw this Chinese guy sitting next to me in line. I just, You know, what a great guy. What a great guy. And I said, you know what? I had compassion. I said, you know, we've got to we got to step back from global war. We have to, you know, that you're capable of being liberated, of trying to fixate the mind, and you will be liberated at some point. So there's nothing to hate there. There's nothing. And I seem to, you know, I seem to get along with everybody. Everybody from any walk of life will sort of confide in me and kind of subliminally somehow tell me, because that's what they want. They want help. So I'm committed to, you know, to helping everybody, because I'm ecumenical. You know, I don't have a favorite race of people. I don't. I see a lot to really love issues in this world. I see a lot of things to love and, you know, needs to, you know, is not so great. Also, you can see that. There's a lot to love there. Including the white race. A lot to love there. They've done a lot of great stuff. You know, just so. I don't race at all. I'm not one of these, you know, white haters. Anyone who feels good about the white race is some sort of white supremacist. There's so many in the white race that are, you know, they hate themselves. They really do. They really hate themselves. I'm not that way at all. I love the white race just like I love all the races. You know, love about all the races of this world. We've all, you know, races are engaged in folly, certain different ways to try to fixate it, and none of it works. But shining is the spirit. You know, you can feel it, you can see it. I'll be dancing, you know, a great dance at some point. You know, once we drop trying, then, you know, the piece has got a piece of God is upon us all, and you know, we'll have quite a dance then. You know, be quite a concert then. After that concert, when everybody is a superstar, everybody, you know, can just sing the song, you know, and harmonize, and you can't do any wrong. What, like, what I'm imagining, you know, groove, and just imagining a great singing thing. You can sing anything with it instantly. So there's no note you can do that I can't have just spin out beautiful harmony with just spontaneously. It doesn't matter. I've got the harmony right here, and you can, and I'm right there with you, right away. You know, with just I just smoothly morph into it. You know, you never lose the seamless at all. There's no like, oh, this is a seam, abruptness. No, transition smoothly, in no matter where you go, make this smooth transition right into it. And I can just do that in my, and that's the way. Is everything is smooth? There's do that you cannot harmonize with and make it that much doing that, harmonizing with one another all the time, spontaneous. That's what reality is all about. There's just vast harmonizing. Smooth and seamless. That's reality. And that's what we'll wonder and sing. For sure, everyone will. No one is lost. We're all an idea. The sonship's one idea in the mind of God. We're all part of the sonship. So they're never going to be lost to that. It's impossible. To lost to that, they'd have to fixate the mind, and you cannot fixate the mind. No one's ever taken one step. So it'll all end well, as Ramana says. Absolutely it will. But there's a lot in the world right now, isn't there? I keep running into them too. And they're sinking. They're so frustrated. They say, my way of fixating them, somebody came in and threw a monkey wrench into it, and I hate this, you know. I keep suffering. I'm for sure I had the way to fix it. Just evil people have come along, and they're beautiful structure, fixate, you know, beautiful structure. And it's like that, right? And so they're really hating so much. They're so angry. Can you sing them a song? That, I don't know. I ran into someone yesterday. I needed some backup singers, you know. I was willing to sing a song, but solo, I can't do anything. You really have to, you know, have the charm of super charm to calm people down, some people down right now. They're edge of just so much self-hatred and hatred every which it's, you know, quite serious. So backup singers, where are you? I'm audition call. Greatest backup singers in the history. We need you. Well, for sure I'd have a horn section, okay? Listening to action, man, is that cool. Love Came to Me. Listen to that song, Love Came to Me by... Just so tasteful. So there'd be a horn section for sure. And he used that is just so cool. Yeah, you know, acoustic guitar, you'd have a bass, you'd have drums, you'd have, you know, some rhythm guitar, electric guitar, you know, doing some rhythm stuff. And, I'd have a pedal steel guitar. And I'd probably have like a ukulele, you know, some general percussion stuff, timpani vibes, like that. And that would work. Pianist, you'd want to have a pianist in there. So a little bit of country, a little bit of rock and roll there. Section, man. If you know how to use it right, the music gets real sweet. I'll put those pedal steel too in there. I don't know anyone's done that, come with pedal steel. But if you could figure out a way together, and then you throw the background singers in there. And get some lead front person singing, and you know, you could calm some people down with that. Now, classical horns, and so the great sound of horns is great. Horn sections, wonderful, but they overdid it. You know, classical music's like overblown more. Especially on the singing, that's of chorus, you know, 100 people, wall, you know, it's too much, and symphonies are too much. Keep it simple. Give some space to it. Hear the different stuff, and just let the listener to weave their own tapestry into the music. Give them enough space so they can do that. Symphonies or operas, too much of a performance, you know, that you're just, there's no room for you, really. If you simplify it all, then you're invited into the performance. That's how I feel. You're invited. And if the music's slow enough and the spaciousness of it, and it's not, you know, you feel just like, oh, stage two. There's room for me on stage. Where this is, you know, orchestra and opera with a huge orchestra, the opera houses, like I've seen some pictures of on sometimes the Bing homepage has a photograph. So what is unbelievable, the architecture and how ornate it is. Oh, it's like the Vienna or symphony house or something. It's like, whoa. It says no, you know, it's overdone, you know, it's trying so hard. It needs to be much more spacious and just, you have all these cubicles where the rich people done so beautifully with the plants everywhere. I mean, it's just done so aesthetically. It's just ridiculous. I don't know, three, maybe. The Memphis horns said it was two. But, you know, two or three horns would probably be plenty. And, yeah. Bass, steel, rhythm guitar. Couple, you know, rhythmist, guitar, string rhythmist, and drummer, and probably would be good. You know, something like that. That's enough. A little simpler than Lawrence Welk, right? He the whole orchestra, you can get a little simpler than that. Audience just, you know, just standing in one area, either standing, you could be seated, but it'd be nice if everyone was just standing. You can clap and move a little bit. You're sitting, it's a little more like you're just there to hear a performance. But if you're standing, it's more like you feel like you're kind of part of it. You're on stage. It's just one big stage. And the audience has their stage and the performers their stage, but it's all, they're part of the stage, but it's all one stage like that. So the audience is part of the experience. Very important part of it, actually. Feeling something, that there's something and trying to structure the mind, it's better to go beyond structuring the mind. It's better to go beyond it. We're called beyond that. Set it down. And sometimes, jazz, improvisational music, improv, sometimes sort of get in touch with, getting free of structuring, just improv. So improvisation. You never know what they're going to play. They don't even know what they're going to play. That's and let the background singers, have the. Sometimes the background singers are the best singers. And just let the audience, let everyone just feel just that doo-wop groove. And just go with that for a while. You don't need the singer to be up there singing all the time. No. It's about the whole. Singer's just part of the experience. A little bit of the ringmaster. You need a certain super confidence to do that. But it's not about them. It's about the whole situation. The sum is greater than the parts. So I miss music. There's no doubt. It could really be quite profound, performing and all that. The audience really wants it, Really want all the drugs. A lot of the audience is on drugs. You can't be on drugs and have an honest. But drugs is just another way to try to structure the mind. Drugs. That's another. One of the ways to try to structure the mind is try to outsmart the mind, and to get into drugs. You think the drugs will just help them outsmart the mind. And so they're, whatever the mind does, they're there with some way to outsmart it, they think. It's like that. It's that kind of, you've met those who are like that, right? They can be quite problematical, that type. Because no matter what you say to them, they just see it as an opportunity to outsmart the mind. Whatever you said, they're going to outsmart it. And some of them get into, they come to non-dual teacher or something, but they try to outsmart the teacher. They think, okay, you're saying this, I got this, zap, I zapped you like this, and he gets into a zapping contest, and you realize, that's not it. This is not dharmic, this is not working. It's a stall out. And they're very prone to drugs. So the audience has to be willing to, let go of their style of trying to fixate the mind and just